everybody. We have a big story for you today. It's about Nintendo. It's about Super Smash Bros. Maybe some of you have heard this already. Maybe some of you haven't, because this deals with the competitive Smash Bros. Scene and what is being accused of Nintendo essentially destroying the Smash community when it comes to competitive gaming. Now, some of you guys aren't going to care about this, but I think there is something to take away from this that is extremely important to be critical of Nintendo of doing, and it's something that I want to make sure we cover correctly. So Nintendo sent out a cease and desist to Big House. I'm not going to go too big into this. They were a company trying to run a Super Smash Bros. Tournament. I'm not going to get into the particulars on that case, but there is a long history of Nintendo literally, I don't know, blocking the Smash Bros. Community from being more than it really is in the competitive scene. And the reason it kind of flew under the radar is everyone was waiting for Nintendo to just give in and finally do something, even if it wasn't monetary support, which is what literally everyone else does for every other competitive game, whether it's Madden, whether it's Call of Duty, whether it's Street Fighter. It doesn't matter what the game is. It's always supported by the publisher with money and sponsorships, but they're not even trying to get Nintendo to do that. This comes from a twit longer. It has been backed up by other people in the Smash community, such as Leffen. So let's just read this twit longer. It's really long, but I feel like it contains a lot of critical details that we need to be sure that we are being critical of Nintendo for. And I understand the person here says that, you know, they're not, you know, that they're hoping a journalist or something to go along and verify the sources. I haven't been able to verify anything. I reached out to a few people. The only thing I've heard from the people I've reached out to, they're from the Smash community, is that when they read this twit longer, this is exactly the experience that they had and that they're aware of and that people have told them. So take that for what it is. Let's just get into what's happening with the Smash community and why Nintendo is just blackballing it for seemingly no reason other than to reap benefits that doesn't actually benefit the community itself. Let's get into the twit longer. So it says, how Nintendo has hurt the Smash community. This was written months prior to Nintendo sending a cease and desist to Big House. It was not written with that context in mind. This is being released anonymously for obvious reasons. You know, people can get in trouble. There's a lot of bad stuff in here. So to begin, I want to state that I am not a journalist. What I am writing below is directly from what I've been told by the individuals who work at these companies and are deeply familiar with the business dealings of these companies by the nature of their position in esports. I did not obtain emails, contracts, or documents to verify their claims. I am merely trusting their word. If a journalist wants to take it to the next level and check everything, I would encourage it. I also want to point out that what I write below does not just include Melee. Most of what I'm about to describe applies to Smash 4, Ultimate, even Brawl as well. All Smash scenes have been held back by Nintendo's actions. I'm writing this for the purpose of making the community at large aware of the things that I and many other members of the community have been aware of for years. Again, a Leffen as an example. That's one massive public Smash Bros. Competitive player that has actually backed these claims. But we're simply unwilling to talk about publicly because of the hope that Nintendo would make something happen. The hope is pretty much gone for me now, so I feel completely okay with sharing what I know. For the longest time, it has been known that Nintendo wanted to avoid supporting the Smash esports scene in a way that helps us grow past the grassroots level. Nintendo is this entity that, for cultural or financial reasons, has simply chosen to not get involved in esports with Smash, at least not on the level that publishers get involved in most major esports. We've heard quotes from top executives at Nintendo many times about their disinterest in competitive gaming. We accept this because it is their intellectual property and they can have whatever vision they see fit for it. However, Nintendo's stance is less innocent when you understand that they also deliberately prevent other entities from helping our scene through various actions or inaction. Furthermore, these acts have gone on while stamping their names on our grassroots events or inviting a few of our personalities to their events. We regularly get a smidgen of hope that they're taking steps in the right direction, but no significant changes ever take place. They directly benefit from our community's existence while providing relatively little support and taking actions that hurt our scene. This note is written to shed light on the different ways Nintendo has stopped the scene from growing. As part of this community, you deserve to know what many top players and influencers in the Smash scene have known for years. The only reason I speak on this now is because I feel we're now at the point where we have nothing to lose. In the past, we'd be afraid to speak publicly because there was some hope that we were so close to having a real esports relationship with Nintendo, only to have that opportunity consistently slip away. Third-party entities that have attempted to work with Smash. There are several entities that have attempted to work with Nintendo to create events for Melee, Smash 4, and Ultimate. The following are just some of the bigger esports entities that were brought up to me. E-League, the organization that has brought Counter-Strike, Street Fighter, and many other games to ESPN, had attempted to throw a large event for Smash. In the end, they only got the rights to rebroadcast the E3 Ultimate Invitational. My source explained to me that the rebroadcast rights served mostly as a consolation from Nintendo, as Nintendo wasn't cooperating on allowing them to run a more meaningful Smash event. HTC. After HTC Throwdown, a successfully capped one-day event ran by HTC Esports, they had an interest in running a Smash circuit with more money than we had ever seen in Smash. However, because an official Nintendo/Twitch circuit was just about finalized, HTC was asked to instead aim to sponsor the main circuit rather than run a competing circuit. Thus, HTC was backed out on running the circuit under the expectation that a Twitch/Nintendo circuit would come to fruition. As we now know, this circuit never came to be, as I will discuss in the Twitch section below. ESL. ESL made an attempt to work with Nintendo and run its own circuit/league, but Nintendo was largely unresponsive. They tried making meaningful contact with the company, prepared decks to sell the idea, but it couldn't go anywhere as Nintendo would not respond. I think it's interesting to note that Nintendo was willing to have Splatoon on ESL. This, to me, shows that Nintendo will support scenes that don't thrive on their own, like Splatoon and ARMS, but they won't touch Smash, because they can hang back and reap the benefits that we create as a grassroots community, essentially letting us do all the work while doing nothing to help us get bigger. MLG in 2015, MLG held an event with Melee, and later with Smash 4. According to my source, MLG did not continue working with Smash Melee after MLG Anaheim in 2015, because Nintendo wanted to charge a $50,000 licensing fee per event, which is over double the asking rate for Street Fighter 4. A much more modern game at the time. This practice to me seems like a way to effectively shut down Melee at MLG without directly preventing them from running it. I would also assume that this fee would be charged and no real support would be provided by Nintendo, as has been the case with some of our grassroots events. There have been other incidents relating to MLG that have been spoken of publicly by former employees and insiders, such as the fact that Nintendo denied MLG the rights to stream Brawl in 2010, that Nintendo denied USA from televising the Smash portion of their events in 2006. And the following quote is from Sundance. "We of course know the Smash community is just as excited as we are to follow the tournament and see what makes their mark on the biggest stage in gaming. And we're committed to doing everything we can to make our coverage of the tournament as comprehensive as possible. However, I'm sorry to say that we will not be able to live stream for Smash in Orlando this weekend. In order to stream something like this, we have to secure live streaming rights from the game's publisher. And despite our best efforts, we have not been able to get permission from Nintendo. Thus far, we kept the conversation going all the way down to the wire in hopes that we'd get an 11th hour approval and could still stream the event. But unfortunately, it didn't happen. I know this is disappointing news, and believe me, we don't like it either. There's no way around it. A company of our size simply has to play by the rules. I know a lot of you have seen local Smash tournaments streamed online and are probably wondering why we can't just do the same. The answer is because we are a real company with real visibility and real things to lose. We can't fly under the radar like a local tournament can, not that we would want to. While the MLG era was a very long time ago, the impact of those decisions hit the scene the most at a point where it was just starting to thrive and would have effectively shut us down had it not been for our revival in 2013 due to the Evo/the documentary. Red Bull, initially it was Red Bull, Twitch, and Nintendo, in talks to start a circuit similar to the Red Bull Proving Grounds for Smash, a circuit where money tournaments would take place across cities in the U.S., and at the end of the season, the top players from each locale would come to compete in a championship event. Red Bull did much of the legwork to get it to launch, but it was Red Bull that was effectively cut from the conversation and the deal altogether. Twitch. Twitch and the later remove Rebel have been in negotiations with Nintendo to run a sanctioned circuit for Smash, including Smash 4 and Melee, starting around 2015. Twitch was fronting the cost of this deal with a budget in the millions per year, while Nintendo would own the League brand despite their lack of financial contribution. During this time, it seemed like Twitch was always close, only to have a conversation left without a response from Nintendo for months, thus delaying the process. Eventually, around early 2018, after 3 years of man hours and efforts to appease Nintendo, the parties came to an agreement. This wasn't just a verbal agreement or an agreement made in good faith. It was a written contractual agreement meant to kick off the circuit for both Melee and Smash 4. This would have been the moment that legitimized Melee and Smash 4 as a major eSport. For years, we had the viewership, the engagement, and the fan base to say that we were a top eSport, but we lacked the official sanctioning from our developer. Now, after years of manpower, money, and stress in dealing with Nintendo, we got a written agreement to start the circuit. So what happened? Unbeknownst to anyone, Nintendo had plans to announce Smash Ultimate in 2018. Nintendo began ghosting those working at Twitch even after the agreement was made. Then, once Ultimate was announced, Nintendo came back to Twitch and effectively stated that the circuit no longer made sense with Ultimate in sight. They told Twitch they wanted to see how the community responded to Ultimate and see if getting involved in esports was a way that would make sense for once the game was released. Twitch was effectively told they'd have to wait again, and that conversation may be revived later in the year when Ultimate came out. So another close call, another year of delay, and no guarantee that they would make anything work once Ultimate was out. It's been a while since Ultimate's release, with no news in sight of a circuit. As far as I've been made aware, those talks of a circuit are completely dead. My personal comments on the entities above, according to my source, the entities mentioned above, every single one of them, have attempted to work with Nintendo while fronting all the costs. In other words, they attempted to work with Nintendo without asking for a dime from them. All they seek is permission. This is not the normal practice. Typically, developers front some money themselves for a chance to run a circuit with companies like Red Bull and Twitch. In this instance, we have Twitch and Red Bull willing to put down a lot of money to run a circuit, and still, hardly anything comes from Nintendo. Another thing to note is that people who have put years and countless hours into making this work with Nintendo also worked on making circuits happen for Tekken, Dragon Ball FighterZ, and Street Fighter. Circuits for those games came to fruition within months. The negotiations were much simpler, yet with Nintendo and Smash, the process has taken over 5 years and counting. At a certain point, it becomes clear that Nintendo doesn't want Smash esports to happen, but they allow people to think it will. If you allow me, I'd like to give my personal thoughts on what this all means. Nintendo knows there's a benefit in keeping the scene hopeful while never shutting us down completely. Think about it. If Nintendo really had such a problem with Smash esports, they could shut it down. Likewise, if Nintendo really wanted us to succeed, they could just apply their incredible resources to make it happen. I have some thoughts on why we get neither outcome and why Nintendo remains conveniently uncommitted to either scenario. Shutting this down completely would be very bad publicly. At this point, we as a community have a voice to influence the actions of major corporations, including Nintendo. It's a marvel of the internet. They famously reversed their reprehensible decision to shut down Melee Stream at EVO 2013 after we raised close to $100,000 to fight breast cancer. We caused a ruckus on the internet, and 5 hours later, we were back on stream at EVO. The effects of that moment ring out today. We're way bigger now, and they know how loud our voices are. Perhaps that is exactly why they only dip their toes and pretend to help the scene. Maybe they don't want to help us grow and get louder. Maybe they don't want to spend money on esports thing. Maybe they think competitive Smash differs from their vision for the game. Fine. However, while all that might be true, they simultaneously do want our voices to give them marketing. A whole lot of free marketing. It makes sense when I think about it. They're always feigning support, never really providing it, and never really stopping us either. Now, you might believe that Nintendo doesn't really need our community to sell games. That's probably correct. However, does it benefit them to allow us to exist as we do? Oh God, yes. I think it's very clear that Nintendo benefits from the influencers that the esports community has created. Hell, Nintendo has even used these influencers for their invitationals at E3 to help promote the game. Look at it this way. Imagine a world where Smash esports wasn't a thing and Nintendo released a direct. You'd probably have quite a few people watching on their competitors, on their computers, in the privacy of their homes. And when it's done, they shut down and move on with their day. What we have instead are the very same people replying to ESAM's tweet, sharing Leffen's video, playing HBox's reaction on repeat. You get hundreds of millions of impressions from fans of these influencers spreading news of the game everywhere. It doesn't take an advertising genius to understand the power of influencer marketing, and Nintendo is getting it not just for free, but while actively suppressing our scene from getting larger, and I think that's awful. Honestly, I find myself echoing a lot of the same things that this anonymous person has done and has said, because Nintendo clearly benefits from influencers. They benefit from me, they benefit from Swanway, they benefit from beat-em-ups, they benefit from Game Explain, and they benefit from people in the eSports scene playing their games, because as those eSport people get big followers, like Leffen and HBox, like when they get these followers, it leads to them having influence over sales of games. That's what happens. This is why celebrities are used to sell products. This is why certain celebrities of a certain stature, even if they're not the lead in a movie, will be put on the cover art for the movie because they know that will make people want to go see the movie or go see the show. Like, this is commonly known that once someone becomes popular, they have a certain influence in the market that can help sales. And Nintendo has actively taken advantage of that fact and used these people to promote Smash Bros. At various events. I mean, remember Hungrybox faced off against freaking Reggie Fils-Aimé on stage, live streamed on Nintendo's official channels. Like, Nintendo is using the Smash community to promote their games, but showing zero support back. Not only are they not supporting it monetarily, they're not even being asked to do that. They're just being asked to say, hey, let us actually play the game in an official capacity on a live stream at an event that is being backed by other sponsors that are willing to front the money. Twitch and Red Bull willing to front millions of dollars to support an actual cash, you know, Smash community. And Nintendo's like, eh, well, we said you could, but you know what? We also knew at the time that we approved this, we had another game coming, and we weren't really going to go through on this contract. Granted, Twitch and Red Bull could have held Nintendo over the coals like Philips did back in the day when Nintendo backed out of the Philips deal, but they had a contract, so they still made the Mario Hotel game. They still made the three Zelda CDI games. So Twitch and Red Bull could have gone forward, or really, I guess just Twitch at that point when the contract was signed, and still ran that circuit, but it definitely would have been a little strange to run that circuit at the time that a brand new Smash game was coming out. Obviously, you know, they just got a signed contract from Nintendo, and then Nintendo said, hey, let's wait and see how Ultimate does. Maybe they actually thought, in good faith, that Nintendo actually was going to amend the contract to include Ultimate, and then they could literally do a massive Ultimate, circuit all across the United States or even worldwide. And in fact, it's curious that Nintendo knew that game was coming and didn't actually throw it in the original contract and use it as a point to launch Super Smash Bros. Ultimate in 2018, because they could have had a worldwide circuit happening for that game before the game even released, like they did for the Invitational at E3. Do you see the things lining up and adding up here where Nintendo is basically benefiting from the existence of a Smash community that they kind of wish wasn't around way back in the day? And now that they're benefiting more and more from that community today than they ever have, Nintendo is still unwilling to give the community the bare basic rights to exist. They're like, oh, we're going to tease you that you can exist officially, but yeah, you know what? We're not going to allow it to happen, which prevents professional Smash players from being able to earn a living like other esports players do. Because believe it or not, folks, esports, whether you like esports or not, takes a high amount of skill, takes a ton of time, lots of practice, just like any other sport does. That's why it's called an esport, because it actually is extremely time consuming. Lots of sleepless nights, weird sleep schedules, hard to find sponsors, and then when you find sponsors, sometimes you end up in these team house situations that aren't as necessarily ideal. There's a lot of crazy stuff that happens with this stuff, but the Smash community is kind of left with just these local, smaller tournaments. Oh, we got Evo, but then like Nintendo rips away the streaming rights in the middle of Evo, only for fan backlash to give it back. Like, it's just, Nintendo, I don't know what you're doing. You either need to, you basically need to make one of two decisions, Nintendo. You either need to say, we're done, we don't want competitive Smash to exist, we're over it. I mean, Sakurai has famously put out their way in the past that, hey, he didn't care about the competitive scene, but now he's kind of come around, and now you see him talk about the competitive scene when he announces new characters. So Sakurai is aware of the competitive scene, and he's not shunning it. So my thing is, Nintendo, you gotta make one of two decisions. You're either just gonna announce that you don't want this to exist, you're never gonna give rights, and just kill it right there. Just kill the Smash community right there, which, again, you might not want to do, because then that ruins the sales ability of some of the celebrities in that Smash community. The other thing is, support the Smash community fully, sponsor events. You know, get involved in the circuits like every other developer and publisher is, and go with it. I think the reason that some people are going to bring up, and I can already see you click-clacking down in the comments below, is, well, why would Nintendo want to do that? Haven't you heard about all of the allegations made against certain Smash Bros. Players dealing with their fans, in particular going after fans that are younger and not of age, and some of the accusations being made there? Of course. But see, this happens in every sport. It happens in the NFL, happens in the NBA, and unfortunately, it happens in esports as well, and it happens not just in the Smash community, happens in all of the communities. I don't think we could take those accusations that, you know, aren't that old at this point, and say that this applies to the whole of the Smash community. It represents people that are bad people, all right? That happens. There are bad people everywhere, in every profession. It doesn't mean that we should just get rid of the profession because of the bad actors. No, you eject the bad actors, make people aware that you're no longer accepting this behavior. No one's going to hide this behavior anymore. You make people be brave and come forward, and you move on. And you start to promote the people that aren't the bad actors, right? That's how you end up moving on as a community. Nintendo doesn't need to distance themselves from the Smash community because there's been some incidents. Guess what? There's been incidents at Nintendo themselves. In fact, they got rid of an employee in particular because of some potential extracurricular activities that were happening in their life. Like, this is beyond reproach. I'm sorry, Nintendo. All right? People always talk about how, oh, you're that Nintendo guy. You know, I criticize the hell out of Nintendo, and I'm criticizing them right now. Get your shit together, Nintendo. I'm serious. I don't even care about competitive Smash. I don't. I have no interest in Smash. I'm not even a fighting game fan. But reality is, I feel for the people in this community being yanked around by Nintendo, acting like they're actually going to support you, and then never coming through with it. And then, oh, hey, by the way, why don't you come and come to our events? And I mean, how you could say, well, just don't, you know, tell Nintendo you're not going to come to your events. But then that makes the community less relevant. So of course you're going to go to the events. Of course you're going to enjoy the Nintendo VIP treatment. Because why wouldn't you? But that's not what the Smash community really wants. They want you to just okay these people to run actual tournaments for cash prizes and advertise these tournaments and stream these tournaments. The Smash community, let me put it this way. Super Smash Bros. Ultimate is the most popular selling fighting game of all time, and it's not even close. Over 20 million in sales. This has the potential to be the largest esport game in the world. This could take out things like League of Legends. Heck, Candy Crush, in case you didn't know that, is a very popular esport, especially in the Asian countries. It could take out that. Super Smash Bros. Has a chance to take fighting game esports to a level it has never seen, because fighting games aren't typically that popular, but Smash is. Smash Ultimate officially sponsored tournaments could just destroy the esports market and run it and set the standards for everything. But Nintendo just won't let it happen. Every step of the way, they tease you and then roadblock you. It's kind of like Nintendo is some chick or whatever, you know, your significant other that, or whatever that you're interested in, and they keep teasing you. They keep teasing you. Oh man, you're like, oh, let me brush up against you. Let me touch you. Let me flirt with you. But it's just a tease. It's just a tease. And then the same tease from Nintendo, they drop their own cock block right in front of it. I know, really bad analogy. I don't care. I think it's ridiculous. Nintendo, get your shit together. Do something one way or another. Either tell the community that you don't want them to exist and be done with it, or actually support the community. This teeter-tottering both ways, reaping the benefits while not supporting the community, but then telling the community you're going to support it, needs to end. I'm sorry. It needs to end. You can't have it both ways. You can't have your cake and eat it too, and we've allowed them to have their cake and eat it too for too long. The Nintendo fan community, whether you like the esports community or not, needs to stand up and start demanding Nintendo do something about this, because right now, the Smash community on its own, the Smash esports community on its own, has unsuccessfully gotten Nintendo to do anything. So now we need the Nintendo community at large to take notice. All right, folks, I'll put a link to this tweet, a link to a thread over on Reset Era about it, and any other links I can find to people that are relevant that can maybe help get your voices heard. I'm not going to start a petition myself. Other people can worry about petitions. I don't know how well those really work. But thank you guys so much for tuning in. I am Nathaniel Robogens from Nintendo Prime, wearing a dang fan-made Nintendo, fan-made Smash Bros. Shirt. Yeah, I expect to get a cease and desist for this video, too. Catch you guys in the next video.